So you turned around and talked to me, like,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I notice you're falling back. I'm like, abandonment.
As soon as I hear like him like burn away, like I cast daze on him. Like I do a single note on my violin and I daze him, the one running.
All right. Do I get a save for that?
No. If he has like, wait, what is it? Fuck, I should open my stuff. It's like, a shitty cantrip.
I ask like the our merchant, what was his name again? Pashar?
Mm-hmm.
Pashar, is there no other way apart from this shady district?
Right, I casted the spell.
I mean, like, where the guy's running away, you turn to me, I don't think, like, we're supposed to discuss things now.
The guy started running, then I casted daze, so if he has like 4 it dice or less, is just skip next round.
The running guy.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Oh, right.
So he quickly my violin and did like one single note, and then I kind of expect my team to do something. Like, quickly.
I see like Valerion turn back to me, so like my trying to pretend I'm not like with them kind of went down the drain.
Mm-hmm.
And the other guy running away. And like, are there any other people or guards around?
No guards, what you can see.
Any other people in this particular time?
Mm-hmm. Just commoners walking to and fro. And even then, it's a very sparse number from what you can see on the road.
Yeah, it's pretty late already. I mean, we're getting close to midnight, I guess.
Mm-hmm. All right, so the guy that was taking off running, he probably didn't get any more, about 10, 12 steps, and then he just stopped dead in his tracks, and he kind of sways around for a little bit.
It seems Inza already took care of it.
Yeah, the other one at the gate, seeing his friend just stop dead, he looks at him, he yells out to him, like, what do you think you're doing? Get going! And he looks back to you all, and you see him pull something out from underneath one of his robes, and it's one of those curved daggers. And he starts just twirling it in his hand, and he steps out into the middle of the gate to block your way.
These guys obviously know something. I think we should interrogate them.
Can I see from the distance any marks on their hands, like the slaver's mark, or is it too far?
I have night vision.
I have dark vision 60 feet, so within 20 meters I see like in daylight.
Okay, yeah, so let's get a regular spot check then.
All right, sweet. God damn, it's fantastic being in ASMR. Asimar, eventually I'll decide.
If he doesn't pass the test, I'm going to do the same thing because I also have
19.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, I mean, it is dark and he is wearing some pretty raggedy clothing, but you do catch a sign of the mark, and it is that same chain link mark on his wrist.
Take them out. It's one of the slaves. And I, at that moment, like a dash forward, immediately going to action, draw my longsword as a move action approach. And I guess we have to roll initiative or something.
All right, let's roll initiative.
Here we go. 6. Yeah, wow. Yeah.
So you dash forward, sword in hand, but you dash very slowly. Oh.
Fuck.
That's fine, I already acted before.
You did the surprise round.
Yeah, because you get a slow to react.
No, we used it to talk.
That's very useful.
Yes, sometimes talking is just better.
Alright.
So the guy wants to smite everyone?
No, I can only smite once a day.
Doesn't mean you don't want to. Okay, so the initiative order is the Thug, Garzhvog, Fate, Valerion, and then Inza. Alright, so he sees...
Is Pashar just like chilling in the back or something?
Oh yeah, Pashar is just like going to get off the road and wait in a doorway until you all finish up. He's not exactly the fighting type, not with a gut he has.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's fine. I mean, we said we'll protect him, so...
All right. So when Valerion charges forward, and the guy sees what's happening, he starts backing up till he gets beside his friend, and he shakes him to his senses, and they both just kind of turn around and get ready for you to come.
Excellent.
All right. So it's Garzhvog.
I guess I wasn't expecting to go first. I'm going to delay till after Valerion. I'll delay till after Fate.
Yeah, I'm a bit late, dude.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. After Inza.
All right. Fight. Fate, what do you want to do?
I'm gonna take my short bow and fire an arrow at the guy who has the dagger out.
Okay. They did get to act right, so they're unflat-footed.
Yeah. Just regular old attack. With
well, I guess it's not much less than my damage.
It's actually, you have pretty crappy damage.
Yeah, you should be the strength.
22.
22, that'll definitely hit.
Yeah. For 2 damage.
3 damage. Alright, so you want to describe how this is going to go down? He's still up.
Yeah, I guess I just take a step right of Valerion, take my bow out and shoot an arrow at the guy. It's nothing particular or exciting. Just more that like hurts. A warning shot, not to like mess with us.
Into the shoulder.
Alright, so then Garzhvog, back to you.
I guess I'll throw a javelin at the same guy, because fuck that guy.
Alright, let's get another attack roll.
Actually, about how far away are we standing from them?
By now, I'd say 15 going on 20 feet.
Okay.
Alright, sounds about right. Am I blocking? Do they have cover? No, right? I mean, I guess I'm still too far out since I didn't get to act yet.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just walking so I can shoot left and right of them. Oh! I'm like flanked by arrows and
17
spears,
will
like...
definitely hit him.
Alright. Cool. 6 plus 2.
Are you shooting on the same one? Or
yeah.
Throwing?
Yes.
It's a javelin? Okay. Why not 5 the double axe?
Alright, and that'll kill the guy.
Because of my axe is melee, I don't feel like walking in to attack somebody with 6 health.
Yeah, that's true.
It's an emergency button.
And that'll kill him, so how does he go down?
We'll keep it simple this time, because I'm a pretty big dude. I throw some pretty big javelins. So this metal javelin, he's already been hit in the shoulder with his arrow, and he's kind of like cringing from it. But as this javelin goes through his chest, it's just beyond the fact he just got impaled. The weight of this giant javelin just carries him to his knees and then to the ground, where impacting the ground pushes the rest of the javelin straight through his body, and he just lies on the ground dead.
I'm really worried about what that's going to sound like when you get access to something like Fireball.
They're all burned to crisp and ashes.
The Fireball. Yeah, the Fireball impacts the ground, and you see them all look in terror towards the explosion. And as they look, their eyeballs melt from their sockets, and all their skin just chars and burns into the air around them. There's nothing left but a crisp of fallen corpses, and the very few that remain are all singed and tattered in tattered clothing. They look around and observe the people around them, the friends they once knew, their companions, simply trying to defend their home and make a living, and all of a sudden, they're nothing but piles of ash.
That was good, man. I like it.
It's going to be a separate episode on its own. Yeah, round of applause.
We're just to like keep attacking like 3 hours.
Yeah, get like 3 kills per session, and then yeah.
I like this. Explain the death thing. This is great.
All right. So Valerion, you're up now. You got to top that.
Well, not really, because the good rolls are gone. All right. I'm just gonna dash forward, longsword drawn, shield ready. What is that? A 12?
And a 12 will not hit him. But that longsword goes out to get him, and he just manages to duck out of the way, and it glances off the little bit of leather padding he has on his shoulder. Unfortunately.
Well, that's life.
Yeah. My turn now, I just step a bit closer and just daze him again.
You can do that every turn.
I can do it like 3 times, yeah. So then that's it. No save.
Yeah, so his head starts reeling again. He doesn't seem sure about his footing anymore. And that'll actually skip his turn and go right back to Fate.
Alright, now there's this massive Valerion guy, like, covering him.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
Didn't even deal any damage.
You know, if you're like Garzhvog, you just pull that bow back as much as you could, shoot straight through Valerion, and hit that guy.
Yeah. Well, I guess you can get rid of cover by shooting at Emilius plus 4 AC for him.
And I'm gonna drop my dagger, like run forward, tumble to the other side, and try to flank the guy, draw my short sword, and slash, slash.
All right.
Let's get a tumble check for that.
Yeah, what's the DC to not provoke?
Yeah,
do I need to really tumble, or can I just
otherwise like run too far? No, like we were 15, 20 feet out. You are halfling, you even have only 20 feet move, right? So, yeah.
Well, I'm not sure I want to tumble then.
Because
the DC is really high.
No, it's probably 15, right?
Yeah, you can, tumble. Yeah, 15, tumble at one half speed is part of normal movement, provoking no. Well, I guess you can't do that. You have to, can't flank now. It's too far, probably.
Then I'm just gonna delay.
Alright, who do you want to go after?
I can just go after Valerion.
Alright, then it's Garzhvog.
And then I guess Valerion is kind of in the way, isn't he?
Well, you can get rid of the cover by just moving sideways, but like you'll still have, because I'm fighting him in melee, he still has plus 4 AC instead of plus 8.
Has anybody hit him yet?
Nope.
No,
this guy's
nobody.
I'm injured.
He's been dazed twice, but he hasn't been hit.
He was like running, and then it was like dazed, and as soon as he like regained consciousness, he dazed again.
What does dazed do?
Yeah,
it's a turn.
And that's it?
Yeah.
Oh, so it's not like a debilitating thing. We can't coup de
grace. No, it doesn't remove his AC or anything.
Okay.
Have to do a bit OP.
Then I'll just. I don't want to waste a javelin.
Well, you could like melee him. Like it's probably not gonna like hit
the
back.
I guess I could. He's just dazed. I'll.
I mean,
chop him down.
Unless you and Valerion miss.
Yeah, that's unlikely, man.
I'm gonna heft my heft up my great axe.
And me after.
And I can charge
always
him.
Daisy McKinnon.
I'm gonna charge. No, I'm not gonna charge him. I'm just gonna walk up and hit him. Garzhvog isn't the charging type.
Yeah, you have to draw your great axe, I think. So I'm not sure you can charge. I don't think you can draw a weapon during a charge.
Oh, okay. I guess that makes sense. I guess the way in my head I've been thinking about it is I've just been throwing all my javelins with my left hand.
You're right. You have a great axe.
In my right hand, I'm just holding my axe.
I mean, it's possible, right?
I tell you, when you start casting magic, you're really going to throw everyone for a loop.
I know. Oh, it's going to be great.
Don't spoil.
Yeah, but I think you would have to take the two-weapon fighting penalty, like if you have an axe in one hand and throw a javelin in the other.
No, I think it's just if you fight with both.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd say he can throw it without taking a penalty from it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I mean, because he's taking the time to be able to put the other arm down.
I guess then it could be possible that he like has it in his left and just swaps, grabs it with his other hand while running. Then he doesn't need a movement.
He can just... Well, he would use his move. You have to move anyway, so whatever.
Yeah.
And he is a massive orc. Let's cut him some slack.
And you probably need your AC anyway, in case you fight back.
Yeah.
All right. So you want to make that attack roll on him?
Yeah, sure.
Wow.
12 will also miss.
Yeah.
My
turn?
He's going
to swing, and he'll duck out from underneath it, and it'll go right into the Valerion.
This is the best dazed combatant I've ever met. He's like dodging all these blows.
10! Well, he is gonna fight back.
Yes.
Wait, no, he's still a fade.
Mm-hmm. Fate and Inza.
And Inza, go ahead.
Okay, I'll move in melee. So I guess I can flank at this point. And there's like two people on him, right?
Yeah.
Probably not because you're too far away, but
I moved closer like next round. So
last round you mean?
Last round, yeah.
Oh, okay.
So I'm pretty close.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So like plus 2 at 20.
Sweet.
And but 20 don't do that much damage. D6 plus 1.
Wait, aren't you blind?
Oh yeah, fuck. Wait. Oh.
Let's see if the 7 goes through.
I have blind fighting, so it's like... Wait, I have to like roll above like 10, That's 10 or 10 or, yeah, above 10 on d20. Ah, and second shot. Oh, come on! I guess I missed. It's fine.
So it looks like it's going to be a great blow, and it comes down on his head, and at the last moment, it just somehow gets out of the way.
It was a great blow at the wrong spot. Just
a bit more to the left, and so a bit more to the left.
Oh. Thanks for the heads up.
All right, so it goes back.
I guess it's his turn after all. Let's see if he downs our necromancer.
So with all these people around him, he's going to turn and he's going to strike out at the weakest one. And so, of course, let's go for the blind.
Of course, I am gonna. Don't crit me again. Don't crit me again.
And what's your AC?
13. Yes.
All right. So that is a hit. So he's gonna strike at you with that Jambia of his. I swear to God, I'm gonna get this one of these days. Jambia.
It's a d3 only, it should be
fine. So 1d3, so 3 damage plus 2, 5 damage to you.
Ooh, close one.
That puts you at a resounding 2 health. Yeah, so he strikes out and he manages to sink it right into your shoulder before popping it back out again and getting ready for more amazing dodges.
Shit! Alright.
Oh, wait,
Garzhvog!
No, wait, you skipped.
I just went further forward, I didn't like go in and...
But we almost have surrounded him.
Okay. I'm sure that gives a special bonus. Wait... No, never mind. Go ahead.
Yep, so it's Garzhvog.
I'll attack again.
Alright.
I'm going to full round attack, but that doesn't actually do anything because I still only get one attack at plus 0, so... Wait a second, okay, that makes sense. I don't know why I'm stupid. I get plus 3, not plus 2. That's a 21.
Oh, yeah. So that'll definitely hit with a 21.
12 plus 3. So I believe it's a plus 3 right now. Let me check. Yep. Oh, and it's a masterwork, apparently.
Huh. Wait, how come is it's a plus 3 for your attack roll?
Aren't because like... it's a great axe. Well, one, it's a masterwork great axe, so normally it'd be plus 2.
Oh, it's a masterwork. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Which I forgot to I forgot to put that in earlier. I have to remember that. Mm-hmm. But you also get 1.5 times your strength modifier.
Yeah, I know that. I was just confused about the attack bonus because it wasn't the masterwork.
Yeah. So it's actually plus no, because it's still plus 3. So 14 damage.
Okay, so that doubles the amount of hit points he actually has.
See right there.
I'll make this person disappear.
I just think and people die. It's great.
Valerion thinks you're a barbarian. He hasn't seen you cast any spells. Just like use a great axe and throw javelins. Wildfighters from the north.
Really? Oh, casted.
I cast the cast fear, but he his will save resistance. Broke it.
just stick to your weapons, man.
Yeah, apparently that works a lot better.
You were meant to be a barbarian.
I'm going to allow this explanation of what's happening with the great axe and the javelin to be the explanation of his death. Just to keep the comedic effect.
Alright.
Or you know what? I did do double his health and damage. He just disintegrates. There is no enemy sitting there anymore.
He's just red gone. Mist.
That's how he's just red. That's right, that's what you said before, is the red mist.
Alright.
Well, except done. For his arm. Except for his forearm. I'm going to keep that with the sign on it.
Another one?
No, I'm kidding. I'm not. No, I already have one. I don't need another.
All right, let's move.
So as the last one falls to the ground, or that little red mist starts settling on the sand at your feet, you start hearing some shrieking from down the street, and it looks like people on the street are horrified at what just happened. And they start screaming and running away, and you start seeing the further down the road, lights start coming out from between the buildings. Looks like the guards are heading this way.
Like, we've been in the city for like a day, and it's like, everybody's gonna hate it.
I got moving.
Hasn't been a full day yet. We've killed 7 people and we have the entire city after us.
And you got stabbed twice.
And we're trying to help these people.
Well, that's...
not the people we're killing, obviously, but everybody else.
We don't really know what we're doing.
So as the guards are coming running down the road, you see Bashar come toddling out from the... from the doorway, and he goes, "Sorry, we really need to get going now." And he goes,
we start
rumbling on down the road.
Come on, guys.
All right. So by now it gets to be about midnight, and the remainder of the little bit that you have left goes by pretty quickly. By the time you reach the other ward that you need to be at, where Bashar's son is, this one looks much better than the one you originally saw. The walls around it are made out of very nicely cut marble. It's well smoothed. The stones are set just perfectly where it almost looks like a mirror sheen going down it. At the gate, there are 2 men in full plate armor, but it's not guard armor. It doesn't have the emblem of the city on it. Doesn't have any distinct kind of markings. It's just very ornate.
I ask Pashar, are those mercenaries?
Mm-hmm. That's how we keep the ward so safe.
Go tell him to let them to let us all in. I mean, if Pashar is able to talk to them about his son living there, I'm sure he could get us access to the ward as well.
All right, so you want to let Pashar go and handle this?
This is his moment to shine.
If he needs help, I'll chop in. I'm a good diplomat.
All right, so he goes toddling up to him, and at first there seems to be a bit of an altercation with him, but after he starts talking to him, he gets a little bit more angry. They seem to either recognize him or understand who he's looking for, and they part ways and they let him go on, and he motions for you all to follow quickly.
All right. So we do.
All right. So just like the wall, these buildings are very, very wonderfully made here in this much richer ward. Instead of just being dirt and sand on the ground here, they actually have cobblestones. Granted, there is still a nice fine layer of sand on them, but it's much better to be actually on a solid ground for the first time. It takes you about 5 minutes of wandering around the roads in this ward to be able to find where Pashar's son is, and he leads you all pretty quickly to him. And Pashar's son, compared to his father's shop, this is an immense improvement. There's columns, it's very beautifully made, there's a lot of intricate designs put in on the walls, there's a few mosaics here and there for aesthetic effect. And it's just a generally beautiful place. And outside there's a couple women, probably slaves, working, and when they see Pashar come this way, they hurry on inside, and just as you get up to the front door, this man comes out, and he looks a little bit like Pashar. He has the same kind of facial features, but he's much better toned, not quite as dumpy as Pashar is. And when he sees you all coming, he goes, "Ah, father, it seems you brought guests with you." Seems a little bit unhappy at seeing you lot.
I'm probably bleeding a bit on his floor.
A little.
Yeah. And Pashar starts really quickly relaying what happened, the thugs attacking the family shop, the burning down of the family shop, the adventure getting over here, and the son just kind of listens, and he goes, "Okay, all right, yeah, please, come inside." He motions for you all to enter his home. All right. And just like outside, this place is very beautiful. In here, there's no dirt or sand on the floor. It's very finely laid marble. Occasionally, there's little bits of tile, but it's mostly marble. There's very beautiful, rich tapestries on the walls here. And it seems like his son has really stepped up in the world compared to his father.
It looks like it.
And as he starts leading you further back into probably some kind of sitting room or something like that, you hear Pashar keep leaning in and talking to him, mentioning like, "Oh, that's a very nice tapestry you got there. Where'd you pick that up from?" And you know, like, who'd you get to cut these floors for? These are very nicely made floors. And the son just, you notice there's a little bit of a disdain between the son and the father. The son doesn't really want to answer much of the questions. He'll just say something like, "Oh, I picked that up on the docks," or just, you know, "Some stone mason was able to make the floors for me." Just seems to try to brush off his father's questions. And when you finally do get to the sitting room, it's just a lot of very plush cushions on the floor. There's a very several thick rugs layered on top of each other here and there, and he just motions for you all to have a seat, as he does.
One more thing, I was like looking out for the marks of the slaves in the household. Like, did I recognize the mark? Or is it a new one?
All right. So you remember Pashar's mark? Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. So it's like that, but whereas Peshara's mark was roughly made, wasn't very the most expert tattooing, this one's much better, has some designs within it, almost like, you know what a Celtic knot looks like?
Yes.
Yeah, so it has the basic symbol, but it has some extravagances thrown in there to make it look a little bit more appealing.
Sweet.
All right, so as you all start sitting down, he starts just making small talk, asking where you all are from, have you all had dinner yet tonight, things like that. Is there anything you all want to pipe in?
Well, we did. I guess we did eat.
Yeah.
Although Inza is kind of still bleeding, so... If you had some kind of like healing potion or poultice or something, you could help
starting
her out.
Starting to get used to it.
And then he goes, of course. And he kind of claps his hands, and one of his girls comes in, and she starts tending to Inza.
Yay.
And so the Sunling Tori goes, yeah?
All right.
Oh, was that it?
He just wants to know about us?
Yeah, I mean, I'm assuming, unless you wanted to add something on from before, we could just skip over that little bit.
Just tell him the basics.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
Okay.
I ask, are we safe here?
And he goes, between the guards outside and my personal household guard, yes, you're quite safe.
Hmm.
Do you have any idea why someone would come after your father?
The son just looks a little just as confused as father. He goes, no, I mean, look at my father. Why would anyone want to go after him? What do they have to? What do they stand to gain from doing so?
Is anybody trying to harm you that they could do it through your father?
Me? No, my father and I have, And he looks at his father and just a little uncomfortably goes, we have a very strained relationship.
And yet you still brought him in.
Well, he is family after all.
So do you have any enemies who may be trying to harm you at the moment? Undo your work or take over your shop?
Well, I mean, I have my own store now and I do my fair bit of trading outside these city walls, but I don't make enemies. I have competition, but... None of them would try something so bold as to kill my family in the night.
As I'm listening to the conversation, I like make a self-sense motive check, see if he's lying. 17.
Alright, now he seems generally just as confused as Bashar was.
Okay. I guess I ask also, like, and who were the two men we killed, those two thugs? Did they have anything to do?
Garzhvog, show him the hand.
I
pull out the hand.
So pulling that out, of the blood starts dripping on his carpet. He goes, oh my god, put that away.
It's kind of done with all the blood dripping stuff. I've actually like wrapped up the end of it, so I can actually use it as like a... Yeah, I just have an arm. Yeah. All
right. He still recoils in horror from the fact that you have a limb in your possession.
Ignore the gore, young man. Focus on the symbol. Have you ever seen it before?
He takes a closer look at the mark and goes, well, that is odd. I've been seeing that these last few months, here and there, but I've never been able to find who owns the slaves. And it's odd, because when someone owns property, it's always near them. Like, for instance, you take a look at my girls and my workers in my store, and they have the mark. They're near me. I'm around them. You know who they belong to. Now, I've seen this mark all over. I've seen it on thugs out on the road when I'm on my way to work. I've seen it on some merchants I've come across that do dealings for their master. I've even seen it in a few of the gladiatorial fights.
And who do you think... So it's not a new sign?
No, it isn't. So who do you think would have an answer to that? Do you have to register this mark? Is it reported to an authority?
No, I mean... No, not really, because once word gets around that you're selling something or you're doing some kind of dealings, it's just common knowledge, but I never found out who owns this.
Hmm.
I look at Fade. You think you can get under the common folk and start some inquiries whom this belongs to. I mean, there must be an answer.
There must be indeed. Do the thugs have any influence here in this district?
Thugs? No, we don't have problems with them. As a
Where's the closest place you've seen the symbol?
I mean, I suppose the last time I saw it was there was a merchant I ran across a couple of days ago. It was a small man. He was working for someone else, and he had the mark on his arm.